Hello everyone, my name is Kim Larsen and I work for Oxford Instruments NanoAnalysis as a Senior Product Scientist. In this tutorial, which is also an introduction to AZtecBattery, I'll present a solution for monitoring of cleanliness in the battery manufacturing industry. In this tutorial, I'll first try to explain why cleanliness is important in relation to batteries and battery materials. This will be followed by an introduction to scanning electron-based analysis, including AZtecBattery, and finally application examples of how AZtecBattery can be used to identify the source of contamination. Why is cleanliness important in the battery manufacturing? Batteries consist of several components, such as anodes, cathodes, separators, current collectors, and electrolytes. Each component is typically made up from powders of different materials that has been mixed and processed to form the anode or cathode itself. This means that there's many different powders involved in it, and thereby it's very easy to get unwanted particles into the mixture. So as an example, the cathode material is often a mix of active material, binders, and conductive additives, and then being mixed with solvents before being attached to the conductive surface. So many powders being involved, many processing steps, quite easy to get impurities into the mixture, which could cause big problems. Contamination by unwanted particles can happen at any different stage in the process, all the way from starting from the mine to the production of the final product. So it doesn't have to happen during the mixing of the particles to form, for instance, the cathode material itself. Different types of battery designs used in commercial products rely on that the batteries are correctly manufactured and doesn't contain impurities, which can cause poor contacts, which can lead to short circuits or just failure of the product. So as lithium-ion batteries are becoming more and more popular and used in more and more applications, it's also becoming more important that they're safe to use, because they are now expected to have a longer lifetime, because the products that are now being used in are expected to be living for longer than some of the cheaper consumer electronics. Generally speaking, when things go wrong, it tends to make it to the news. So safety-related issues can be quite expensive, not just because of PR, but also because of potential recall issues. So having the correct solution for the given implication is very important. So over the years, there have been several stories about how batteries have been had to be recalled because of issues that could potentially have led to causing fire or spontaneous combustions. However, there's also been stories about how some of the powders that are used to form the battery material has been contaminated at a much earlier processing step. So it is a well-known issue. So the powders that are used for the battery manufacturing must be free of contaminants. They typically must have a predefined particle size and have the right chemistry. This is all to ensure that the batteries that are being produced in a consistent way. So changes in particle size will lead to changes in the properties of the battery as well. Changes in chemistry will change the performance as well. So if the particles are not right, or consequences of contaminants coming in, well, it could lead to weaknesses in the finished product. It could, if the particle size and shape is not right, it could lead to potential more porosity in the material, which again would affect the performance of it. In extreme cases, it leads to failure of the battery itself, so it could be that there's an electrical particle that's come in and has caused a short circuit at a place where you have an insulation barrier, and that can lead to problems such as basically thermal runaway on the battery. So on the right-hand example, it's shown an electron image of one of the powder materials that's typically used in the lithium-ion batteries. So in this case, it's a cobalt oxide. So it's one of the earlier precursor materials for using the cathode. And we're looking at the particle size. You can see there's a quite large variation in particle size, but you can also see that there's actually some contaminants in the powder. So it's very important to control not just the contaminants, but also the particle size before we start processing the material. So SEM-based analysis, or scanning electron microscopy-based analysis. So what information can we get from the SEM? Well, in the SEM, we have an electron beam that is focused onto the sample surface, and the interaction between the electron beam and the sample itself generates a range of signals, which we can use to extract information about the sample. Some of the most commonly used signals are secondary electrons, so electrons that's been knocked off the away from the sample, so it will give us information about topography and morphology. It could be high energetic backscatter electrons, which has interacted with the nucleus itself, and thereby it will give us atomic number contrast, so it will show where we have density variations, where we got heavy elements, where we got light elements. The interaction between the electron beam and the sample also generates X-rays, which are characteristic for the elements in the sample itself. And by detecting and analyzing the X-rays, we can get information about the chemical elements of the sample. So how are we going to use this information? So we can create electron images by using the SE or BSE detectors, so secondary electron or backscatter electron detectors. And that'll give us information about particle morphology. So what's the shape of the particles, what's the size of the particles, how are they distributed, and so forth. If we use the backscatter detector itself, it is also sensitive to atomic contrast, so density variations. So based on looking at the gray level images, or the gray levels in the image, we can get indications about compositional differences. And if we use EDS, so energy dispersive spectroscopy, we can start to analyze the X-rays that come off a sample, and we can start to quantify those differences that we can see in the backscatter detector. So what is EDS analysis? Well, EDS was energy dispersive X-ray spectroscopy. So it's a technique where we use a silicon drift detector to detect the X-rays that are coming off the sample after they've been generated by the interaction between the electron beam and the sample inside the electron microscope. So by detecting the X-rays, processing it, we can measure the X-rays and characterize them for every single position on the sample surface. And by analyzing the X-ray spectrum, we can say what elements are present in the sample. So generally the peak height in the spectrum relates to the abundance of the element. In the microscope, we can scan the beam over the sample surface, thereby we can create an image of the sample. And at the same time, we can collect the chemical data, so we can collect the X-ray spectra, and we can then reconstruct that into a colorful chemical map that shows the variation of chemical elements. So thereby we can see variations in chemistry, and we can quantify the chemistry, so we can determine what is the exact chemistry at the given position in the sample. So easy to identify features in the sample that way. We can, however, also use the electron images to detect features. So if we're looking at a backscatter image from a sample containing particles, well, typically the particle will have a higher density than the background it's sitting on. So you'll see a black background with gray particles on it. If we threshold using our gray level thresholds, we can easily separate or segment this image to only show where there's a signal above background level, so where we have our particles. We can set filters on what's the smallest particles you want to detect that way, and we can then easily use that as a filter for where do we want to go and collect the chemical information. So if we in this way combine data from backscatter imaging, gray level thresholding, and chemical analysis, it becomes very easy to detect where features are and get chemical data from those in an efficient way without spending the time getting data from the background, in this case the sample the sample substrate. So using SEM analysis combining backscatter detectors and EDS gives us a very efficient way for detecting and analyzing particles in the SEM. AZtecBattery is a solution which optimizes this recipe for analysis of powders that are typically used in the manufacturing of battery materials and batteries. So it's using the same principles as just talked about, so in the SEM, using backscatter imaging and EDS analysis. So AZtecBattery has a user profile in AZtec, whereby all the settings have already been preset by experts to try to streamline the analysis process. So it's easy loading dedicated profile, and all the settings are immediately set up and ready to use. In the software, we have what we call step notes, so basically set of text that tells you what to do at each step in the software. This can be very useful both for guiding experienced and novice users through the analysis process. It helps to make sure that we're following the same SOP, so the same standard operating procedure all the time. makes it very easy to train new operators, and it ensures consistent results across multiple sites. What we want in an industrial environment where we're trying to control the manufacturing process to ensure consistent outcome. So using the methods that I described earlier, the particles are rapidly identified, classified. So using a classification scheme that's set up around what is it we're expecting to see in these powder materials that's used in the battery industry. And thereby we can classify the particles as we're finding them and say, well, this is a cobalt oxide particle, this is a manganese oxide, and so forth. And it's covering the most common materials, metals used in the production of cathode materials or undesired contaminants. So we can quickly classify as in what is an expected contaminant, what is expected to be in the powder. The classification schemes can easily be customized if that's necessary for other applications. With that overview, I'll go on to an example of how we can use AZtecBattery in real life to try to identify sources of contamination. So in this application example, we're looking at contamination as found in raw materials used for the production of cathode material used in lithium-ion batteries. So we're trying to identify the source of the contamination. So in this specific case, say we're looking at cathode material, but in principle, the process could apply to other parts of the manufacturing process. So cathode is typically made from a mixture of metal oxide powders, such as cobalt oxide and manganese oxide. And it's important that there are no contaminants in these powders, as particle contamination can cause the failure of the final product. So as an example, large or relatively large metallic particles can lead to short circuits. So in this specific examples, we're looking at cobalt oxide powder, and we're looking for contamination sources for silver, copper, and zinc particles with a diameter of more than 1 micron. So we can use the filters that we talked about beforehand to use our backscatter imaging filter on size to look at particles that are above 1 micron and then try to determine the chemistry of them. So the process way we go around this is we take the cobalt oxide powder samples out at different processing steps along the production line to try to identify where do we start seeing the copper, the silver, the zinc particles in mixed with the cobalt oxide powder. So we can use the backscatter signal to set up the gray level thresholds, and then we can use the EDS to identify what is the exact chemistry of the particles. So before these automated solutions, such as AZtecBattery, this would have to be done by an operator who would manually have to sit and find the particles and identify them and collect data from it, try to work out what they are. This is now fully automated with AZtecBattery. So we set the thresholds and AZtecBattery takes control and collect the chemistry and classifies the particles. So by taking out particles from essentially the mine, the trucks that transported the powders, and all the steps in the processing further on, we can quickly characterize and identify all the particles in there, and we can see at which point do we start seeing contamination particles. So in this example, when do we start seeing copper contamination? In this case, we can start seeing, well, there's no copper contamination when powder comes straight out of the mine, can verify that, but we can see that some of the air samples that's taken out from the trucks that we use to transport it actually have copper particles on them. So it's not just the powder samples themselves we can look at, we can look at samples taken from air filters to try to see where do we start seeing contamination particles in the environment where the material is being handled or being processed, and that way we can identify when does the contaminants get introduced. Similar story, we can find when the zinc comes in, which is at another processing step further on, where basically the cobalt oxide powder was handled very close to where there was zinc oxide powders. So very easy to identify the step at which it gets introduced, and we can also use it to try to ensure that when we're working in a clean environment that it is actually as clean as we're expecting it to be, again by comparing particles collected by air filters in the production environment. So very easy to identify the source of the contamination, and when we know the source of contamination, we can start to put precautions in place to prevent the contamination from occurring in the future, whether that's by separating different process lines or whether it's doing more thorough cleaning before transporting the new powders into the environment. So hopefully this has given you an idea about how microscope-based analysis can be used along the process line. So it's not just for looking at the final powders. We can use SEM analysis all the way from mining or extraction facility up till the production of the final product. And this covers things like automated mineralogy, so trying to identify not just what it is we're mining, but also combining it with solutions like AZtecBattery to verify the cleanliness, the quality of what's been mined, of the powder that's been produced. We can verify that it doesn't get contaminated during handling, process, and storage. And we can use AZtecBattery as a solution to check that it's still of suitable quality at each step along the production line. And hopefully with that, you've got an idea about what AZtecBattery is, how it can be used, and how SEM-based analysis can be a benefit in an environment such as for battery manufacturing, where it's very important to control and monitor the cleanliness of the final products so that we all have safe batteries for our cars and other electronic appliances.